I had a list. I got stuck with that one for 5 years. I'm just here doing this. I'll show you the life of the mind.
I love Barton Fink.
Couldn't get him angry. Now, see, I love. So, what do you think Barton Fink's about?
What do I think it's about?
Yeah.
Look back. I've seen it 3 times, but I haven't seen it in a long time. So, what would I say Barton Fink is about? Probably the life of the mind, the life of the writer's mind. What do you think?
Yeah, I think it's about writer's block.
I think it's about writer's block. I mean, that's on, you know, obviously. Yeah. It's.
I think it's all the whole thing is structured from beginning to end about.
The whole thing is structured beginning to end. John Goodman may or may not even exist.
I don't think he. I think he exists at the beginning, but I don't think we, after that, the first time we meet him, I think he exists. After that, I don't think
he exists. It's kind of like Gravity. I think Sandra Bullock is dead. I think she runs out of air in the beginning.
Huh.
And I think the rest of it. So I think it's interesting. I think Alfonso Cuarón, if that's the, what I feel is how it is. Then he made a really interesting studio movie on existentialism, which I think he got away with Highway Robbery on that one, because I think like if a studio, if he came to a studio and said, I'm going to make a movie about space and existentialism, I don't think that would work. And I think the ending totally works if you go back and think that she's dead the whole time.
Yeah. Huh.
But that's just my take on it.
I like that. You should be a film critic. You have a whole other career starting.
I have a whole other career. I could. I parse things. I think.
You do.
I do.
So you've been, I saw your CBC interview yesterday.
I was in Toronto yesterday.
Toronto, yeah, minutes ago.
Minutes ago, I was in Toronto. I mean, it's so, travel is so trippy. It really is weird when you think about.
These days, yeah.
Times, I mean, and also that it should be faster by now. I think we've moved beyond the 5-hour flight, people. I wish I could have gone on the Concorde.
Back in the day.
Back in the day.
You think it'll ever come back? I don't even remember why they stopped it, but.
It had one plane crash.
Yeah.
Which,
wimps.
Well, I mean, it seems like every airline has had a crash.
Pretty much. We hope not. Anyway. So you are at the point of launching your... Well, you've already launched your short. I mean, this is already... You've been down this road now for 10 months with this...
Sundance. Sundance, whenever that was. That was January. End of January. And it was like January 29th, I think, is when it premiered.
So it's
like
9 months.
So it's a baby.
So has it been, have you felt like it's been a long process, or is it kind of spurts, these moments that happen? And
I think it's spurts. Yeah, I think it is spurts, because it's the moments are, you know, it was also in the Seattle Film Festival, and then it's been in a couple other ones as well, and it's now tonight it's opening here and starting to qualify, which is for the Oscar, which is intense and cool.
And do you, I mean, I know the first time I ever spoke to you, and probably the last time I spoke to you was in Sundance. A decade or plus ago, I think, for Jawbreaker, when you
I
were
was a, baby.
A small child.
I was a child.
Does it feel like forever ago? Is it a completely different
feels
experience?
Like a totally different person.
Huh.
I mean, I've always been me. My aunt met me when I was 3. Mm-hmm. She came over to Italy where I was living, and she's like, I've never met any human who's changed less in their entire life. I said, thank you. She's like, it's not necessarily a compliment. It's just a statement of fact. So I know it's the same. I mean, it is a very weird, you know, I was discovered standing on a street corner crying and for a Greg Araki movie, and I wound up doing that, and then within 2 years became hugely famous, and then didn't stop working and didn't come up for air, and never really until about 7 years ago. It was like a Lemony Snicket's unfortunate series of events happened. Like kind of big life events. And then I was like, peace out, Hollywood, and largely took off, except for here and there little things when I would come back and I was like, oh, I need healthcare. Okay, fine, I'll do this. But it really, to grow up, and you met me when I was very young, to grow up while being other people, the majority of your time pretending to be other people, wearing clothes that you wouldn't wear, eating food you wouldn't eat, hanging out with people you wouldn't hang out with, forging weird relationships, having sex with people you wouldn't ever have sex with, or fake sex, whatever. Stuff like that is a very weird way to grow up. It's a very weird way to come into adulthood, to find your own voice, and to figure out what you are, and what you want, and what you're about. While, especially when I was on a TV show, playing somebody else for 17 hours a day, is deeply fucked up.
Were you conscious of yourself at that age, or were you just...
Oh, completely. But I was conscious. I always knew I was going to be famous. From when I was little. And it wasn't what the big deal was. I never sought it out. That's why when it happened, I was like, okay. I was a very weird kid when I was 10. I never picked my nose because I could, invisible cameras were following me and I had to have perfect manners at all times. Like, what? Like, where I got that? I don't know. My family, we watch classic films. That's what I studied with my father since about age 4. And that was a really great education. So when I was discovered, quote unquote, I just thought, oh, my love of film, this must be what I'm meant to do. This makes sense. And then you get caught up in this weird machine. And then you get turned into a human Barbie doll.
Pretty much.
And that's not me.
Well, that was, I mean, there was always that sense.
I was always the outsider.
Yeah.
I was always an outsider because I didn't understand the politics of this town. I didn't understand how to work this town. I wouldn't have worked it anyway because it's a bit of an anathema to me. I don't know how to sell myself as a product. I know how other people will sell me, but I don't know how to sell myself. Whereas there are a lot of famous people who are very good at it. They're good at it. They're
so
good
you
at
had you were kind of iconized, you know, like right off
like,
the bat. I mean, there was a very distinct
right off the bat
image of what you were. This very smart, but very sassy, for lack of a better word. I don't know, sexualized.
Very
youth.
Sexualized.
But you were still pretty young, and it, people were so it was
19.
This dichotomy of, you know, the edge of it, and then the roles you were playing were also kind of hard ass women.
Yeah.
Young women.
I mean, I don't know. What's the option? There's so, there are limited choices, obviously, of what you're allowed to be so far. And for me in my life, I'm just done being allowed to be anything. I'm just no longer interested in people that will allow me to be anything, because who are you to allow me to be anything? How dare you?
So that really changed in the last number of years as you kind of...
And really specifically, this last year has been a huge shift for me. The power went out in my house, actually, and smoked some pot. Couldn't get out of the house, garage doors, electrics, shields shut. I was like, fuck.
Wow.
10 hours later, I'm still sitting there. And I actually really had time to think. And no distractions, phones dead, all that stuff. And I had the epiphany that I'm in the wrong job. Oh my God. Oh my God, I've always hated this. Oh my God, I hate this. And not the acting part. Everything that kind of came along with it. In the last 7 years, without being totally aware of what I was doing, I was completely disengaging and separating. I don't think of myself as well known. I think I'm well known, but not famous like I was. And that's cool, because I didn't want that. I retreated. I needed to regroup. My father was sick and dying. I took off to take care of him. I went to Seattle for a long time. Got in a car accident. Got paralyzed on my right arm during a movie. Spent 2 years in a thing. On a machine, trying to bring it back to life. They took 3 parts of my elbow out. So Lemony Snickets. Father died. Weird relationship. All that stuff. And then I just traveled the world. You know, I just needed to heal and be a human.
So do you...
Not a human who was busy being other people.
So are there any regrets in all of that? Or is that just the road you take to get to where you are?
I mean, I regret... I don't know. I think, kind of honestly, I think I was really ahead of my time. I think things have finally kind of started catching up a little bit. People are a bit 20 years behind. Kind of like Australia. No, I'm just kidding. I like Australia. Don't get me wrong. Sydney, a little 20 years behind with the food, but just got back from there. Yeah, I guess so. Yeah, I regret things. And I don't know why your people are like, don't regret. Why? It's an emotion. Am I not allowed to, have a feeling? It's a feeling. It doesn't mean I sit there and ruminate on it and that I'm... You know, I'm not like, but I did have my own like Kafkaesque metamorphosis, you know, this last year, very much so.
So is being behind the camera a completely other experience for you than acting has been?
It was, for me, the first time pants felt like they fit in my life. I felt deeply uncomfortable in the role I was cast in my life. And I didn't know how to get out of it. Once you become, and it was like a microcosm of a world, once you're on the cover of Rolling Stone, like, it's weird. It's not right. And I think that actually that Rolling Stone cover was my tipping point. I was on the cover with this, like, they gave me this bouffant hairdo, with this weird retouched hairline, really fake tan skin. I'm naked except for an ammo belt around here, boob to boob with Rosario Dawson. Like I'm like, who the fuck is this shit? What is this shit? Am I allowed to curse?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. What is this shit? Like, who are you? That was really like the done.
for me. Funny because I think
I didn't exactly alert people of the fact. It wasn't like I'm retiring or like on Twitter or something. I didn't like alert the, you know, the media. It was just like, peace out, losers. It was really much more about that.
Well, I think the perspective from outside would be that like in that situation, that Rosario was the one who was pushing the envelope, and this was very normal for you. So it's interesting that that's kind of your tipping point.
Well, that's an outside image.
It is. That's what we all
have.
Live with. Yeah. And it's hard to break through. I mean,
when you think it's part and parcel of your job,
yeah,
that's a fucked up job. And for me, I was raised in a very gender neutral environment. I was not raised to think of myself as a girl, and this is a boy, and this is what you're allowed to do because you're like this. And all of a sudden, I'm in a world where you're allowed to do only so much because you are, in fact, a girl. So it was like a daily weird punishment for being a female. She doesn't work for me.
Well, it also sounds like you were never on the fame trail.
I didn't understand it. Frankly, it freaks me out. I feel like, and I've worked with a lot of these people. I've been around a lot of these people. My only actor friends are Jim Gandolfini and Peter O'Toole. Mm. And it doesn't mean I dislike actors at all. I love some of them, just like you like some people and you don't like others. But it is a weird, like Jennifer Lopez is beautiful, amazing. Her talent, I think, more than any other talent, is like this ambition. Mm-hmm. And she has worked her ass off, and I have mad respect for that. Was I born with that sort of thing? No. Just as a person, I don't have that. I was raised to live in my brain. We were told we were not a sporty people. We never played sports. We just read. We played a game called Authors growing up. We were all the nerds that, like, it was a card game where if you got Nathaniel Hawthorne's card, you had to name everything Nathaniel Hawthorne wrote as fast as possible. Otherwise, somebody would interject and win. I mean, we were like 7, 8 nerdy kids in a house, homeschooled a lot. Mm-hmm. My parents were very eccentric, to other people, I suppose. To me, just interesting weirdos and very, very smart. My mom speaks 5 languages, graduated Phi Beta Kappa double major. These are serious intellectuals. These are not stupid people. And I was raised in all of a sudden an environment with some very stupid things.
Well, besides being smart and sharp so that you could respond to things that were going on, does the intellectualism of knowing literature in
it
a real way...
It doesn't help.
Is it a hindrance? Is it?
It was a hindrance. It was a hindrance to me to be around people that are filmmakers that aren't aware of art, that aren't aware of literature, that aren't aware of film history. Mm. It's a hindrance because I have a line inside my mouth where I chew it. And I used to hide behind really long hair. I would just put my face down on set and just start chewing away. Mm. You're like, just push it down. You know, and I've had some great times. I've had some amazing experiences. Do not get me wrong. I've had a pretty great moments. Mm-hmm. Would I, going back in time, have said, yes, I will do this? I don't think so.
What was interesting in the conversation on the Canadian broadcasting, what was the degree to which you were proud of your professionalism and the fact that you had...
I'm extremely professional.
...put in your time and you had put in your hours and you really, you know...
I am. If they say 5,000 hours is mastery of something, I don't know exactly what that makes me. I've conservatively estimated it at 17,000 hours on sets.
So that's that's part of your, because that's, again, from the outside.
That is pride. I have a pride of professionalism. I have pride of working. I am one of the hardest workers I know. I show up early. I know my lines. I do my work. I help. If someone needs a stinger plugged into a wall, I'll plug that stinger into the wall. If someone needs a C-stand, I'll give you a C-stand. And I can do it faster and be there and without having to wait. And my thing is like, let's get this done.
So directing is kind of perfect for you because you get
completely
to do everything.
Completely perfect. Yes. And I did the set design as well, which is huge for me. Hmm. And I just played an assassin in something, some little thing. And I was like, the house they got for me was, I liked the character. I liked everything. I got there and I didn't believe the house. The house was kind of like your house. There was stuff everywhere. I mean, like books, knickknacks, this. She was an assassin. What? She's going to pack up all her books every time she has to move? Like, this makes no sense to me. So now you've just made my character less believable because you as a director didn't notice that you set me in the wrong world. And so... would I like to have control over that kind of stuff? Absolutely. So and then someone watches it and they're like, I don't really buy her in this character, but people don't really realize there's so much. You support your actors and the characters that you've created or have been created on the page by providing them with a world that's completely believable and natural to them. And that's one of my main missions and goals is I want somebody, when I'm telling a story, I want somebody in the theater. I mean, of course, there's going to be little missteps here and there. It's just we're imperfectly we're just imperfect. That's how it is, as humans, as directors, as anything. But to the best of my ability, if I can keep people what my goal is going to be, if I can keep people in the story I'm telling without them all of a sudden thinking like, oh, something's not really right about this, or this movie's too long, or this, because then you're checking your phone, like, fuck, I gotta get out of here. Now, all that hard work that director has done to put this on the screen, you're back out of it. You're out back into your own world. And I want to transport people. I'm Irish. We're storytellers. That's what we do. And that I have loved being a part of. I have loved being a part of telling stories. What I read, what I like, are things that are just different than what I've done, which is really interesting. I have stuff I've done as an actor I would have no interest directing. And I'm not poo-pooing it, because I've done stuff that people love, and I love that they love it. And there's obviously parts of it that I love to do it. Would that be what attracts me? Is that my taste? No. Is that my sensibility? No.
So what is your sensibility? I mean, we know a little from your film, but...
Probably that. I mean, once somebody sees that would be my voice. That would be closest to my voice than of anything I've ever had. That speaks more for me than anything I've ever said or anything I've ever done in my career. For sure. Taste level, everything. Absolutely.
So subtle, surprising, demanding.
Fuck with your mind.
Fuck with your head.
Psychological warfare.
So are there authors or writers who you particularly connect with?
You know, I was originally actually meant to do a Flannery O'Connor short. And I love Flannery O'Connor. I lost the rights at the last minute. Mm-hmm. I had the 4 locations for Dawn. Mm-hmm. And I was leaving the 4th location, and RSA Black Dog produced it. And they've been great. But, you know, you've got these like big producers sitting next to you, and you get a call that you've lost the rights. You now have no screenplay. But you have 4 locations. You're like, oh my God, that's a nightmare. That's a nightmare. So you act. Your way through that uncomfortable moment, and then the writer saved me. The writers, I mean, I love English lit. Like, actually, I've been reading about this Order of Nuns. This is not English, it's Spanish, but like, I was curious how Queen Isabella behaved during the Spanish Inquisition towards the nuns, because she was, you know, Catholic, and I was wondering if she protected some of them, so I've been researching that. I don't know if all, there was a nunnery called Las Golondrinas that I was fascinated by. It's like in the 1530s. So I'm fascinated by stuff that is a bit arcane.
So how did you make the relationship with RSA?
You know, I was really lucky. My husband, I got married 10 months ago. Okay. 11 months ago. Thank you.
Another finally. Change in your life.
A major, major change. I'm like phobic. I broke off 2 engagements. I was like, but I think people should do that. I think it's the adult thing to do. Why get married and get divorced if you already, I think a lot of people, I'm off topic now, but it okay. is something I've asked people that have gotten divorced. I said, did you know when you walked down the aisle, did you have that feeling? And they said, yeah, every single one of them said yes. And you never know, obviously, what's going to happen in life or things that are forces and this. But back to my husband. He's an amazing artist, right? And he worked with Black Dog, produced one of his art shows. And he does like huge murals all over the world, and then smaller pieces as well. And that's something that really helped me, was being around artists and art community, because I didn't have that. I didn't have artists around me. I had people that were moving things as product. And my father was an artist, and I grew up with artists. And then all of a sudden, for the breadth of your career, to be around people that are like, well, their Q rating is down, talking like that. You're like, it's just not what I was used to or bred for. And so if you're a vessel and you're trying to be filled with art and creativity and all this, and yet you don't have it around you, and now you're very lonely, you're trapped in this weird situation, and I didn't feel like an artist. I felt like an actor. I felt like a journeyman actor, and there's nothing wrong with that. I love that. I'm a worker amongst workers. I'm a team player, but I will also captain that team. But when I'm employed as an actor, I am there servicing the director's vision. And I completely understand the delineation in those. So it's funny. It's going to be really funny to see like people that are like, oh, are you going to try to direct this now? No, that's you. That's all you, man. Or woman. Hopefully woman.
So we're still going to RSA.
Oh, RSA. I get okay. Well, it's a half an hour. I make my way back.
I don't mind the drift.
That's me. I'm a drift. I'm all about like... Sorry.
It's okay.
I apologize. RSA, well, so they got involved with Dawn because, and it's interesting because they produced, the woman that produced it produced like the Blurred Lines video, which is weird, and the Miley Cyrus video. They produce like huge things. They, the DP I used is Floria Sigismondi's DP, and he did this 10-minute Sigur Rós video with her. So I used all these people that were at the top of their game in commercials and music videos, but had never done narrative. And so getting involved with them, and it's interesting because when I met this woman, this producer, Colleen Haynes, and I met her in Hong Kong, actually, and told her about Dawn and, or at the time, the Flannery O'Connor piece, honestly, what I wanted to do. And she's like, great, let's do it. And I do wonder, had I met a woman in film, I don't know that that would have, but they also wouldn't have had the DPs, this, you know, all these things, these great resources that I could use. But it's interesting because what I know is story. Mm-hmm. And I know the other parts as well, obviously. I've been doing this long enough. But it was great fun taking people. And I think some of them have no interest in narratives now. It's like, we had to spend all day in a bedroom? And you're like, you're lucky it wasn't 2 months, pal. You're like, that's nothing.
Yeah.
It's a totally different animal, you know? But we've forged great friendships, worked so well together. And in that, it's a more egalitarian community. The female thing is not an issue at all because it's just a lot more integrated. They tend to be younger. They tend to be a lot more progressive in that world than this one.
And none of them from Hollywood, really.
No.
I mean, a few of them, but not many.
Not many. And real, like, eclectic weirdos, which I like, you know, and artists a lot of the time.
So, yeah, I mean, it's funny because it's kind of become, like, Funny or Die has become the outlet, the funding outlet and the, you know, production outlet for a lot of young actors and middle-aged actors, whatever age actors, the 30s, who want to, you know, find another route of expression and kind of Funny or Die in a very broad way, obviously, is kind of create, I think that created that allowance for people.
Mm-hmm.
But it's great that RSA is keeping that door open also.
That's, I don't know that that's what their business is. I don't, you know, that's...
Well, I think they do it. I think Anonymous does it. You know, they're very supportive of their talent.
They're very supportive of their talent, and that's really great. And it's nice being recognized as a talent that's worth supporting.
So how long did you work on... it sounds like you worked a long time on developing it, and then you had to make a change at the last second.
2 days. The writers, I locked them in a room at a hotel, and the writers are so brilliant, and they saved my ass. And ultimately, it turned out for the better. Mm-hmm. I had Piper Laurie cast in the Flannery O'Connor piece, but it would have been like an 86-year-old person in a forest at night getting shot in the back of a head. I was like, how do I kill Piper Laurie? How do I kill Piper Laurie without killing Piper Laurie? Oh, that was my.
So you just decided not to kill Piper Laurie?
Well, I lost the rights to kill Piper Laurie. So I no longer needed to kill Piper Laurie. But yeah, what a tremendous actress.
Yes.
What a tremendous career.
Well, I love, there's this movie, Dead Girl, which I don't know if you know.
No, I haven't seen it.
Which I adore, from maybe 10 years ago now, that she's in, and she's fantastic in it.
She's fantastic.
It's like this whole series of actors who kind of get this chance to shine. It's a female director whose name I'm forgetting.
Oh, I want to see it.
Just be friends with. It's fantastic, little, very little, harsh movie, but brilliant little picture. And it's like a series of people who lead to this Dead Girl, who's also a character in the film. So it's
that sounds fascinating. I will try to Netflix that.
Yes. I hope it's on Netflix. I hope for
something.
Its sake it's on Netflix.
Now I have to search.
It's one of those great... Well, you can look up Piper Laurie.
You're right.
It'll be right around the corner.
That occurred to me also, by the way. I was like, oh, I can do that.
Everything's connected now.
Everything's connected.
Do you feel like everything's connected? Do you feel like your history is sitting out there? People are still...
Oh, completely.
You're a 20-year-old and going, I know her.
Yeah. It's weird. I came back and in my absence I was like, oh... Like, I have a really bit large fan base, a very ardent and very passionate fan base. And what I love about them is that they're people that can't really be sold to. Mm. And nobody's ever understood how to monetize me. You know, like, I had publicists here that were like, I think they'd be proud of themselves if they got me in the Us Weekly fashion pages. I'm like, I don't want to be in the Us Weekly fashion pages. I don't want to be in Style. These aren't the stuff I do is primarily European. Mm-hmm. Like, big fashion magazines. I'm very entrenched in the fashion world as well. Because I've worked with some of the major photographers in the world. That's an art form, and I love art. And working with them and alongside of them and growing with them has been that's part of what's been a great experience, a byproduct of the acting for me. What was the question?
I don't remember anymore.
Okay, good. I'm glad. I don't either.
No, you were talking about your fan base and the fact that people are still following you from 20 years ago and from 10 years ago. And
I have 13-year-olds. I mean, and again, they're the people. Somebody asked me, they're like, which role do you think it is? And I have each person likes their own thing or whatever it is. But I think overall, it's something about whatever, the a punk spirit or something that they relate to.
Well, you have an energy that's just, you know, hasn't really changed.
No.
I mean, you're definitely a grown-up now in a way that wasn't apparent some, you know, a long time ago.
When I was 19.
Yeah. But, I mean, it is apparent. It's pretty clear. But you don't seem very different.
No, my aunt said I never changed.
Yeah.
No, and I think there's something to that. You know, I think there's something holding true to yourself, whatever that self is. And I had to hold hard to hold on to a true self.
And it doesn't sound like you ever went through the kind of fucked up, selfish version of that. I mean, obviously you've gone through trauma in the last couple of years.
I went through trauma my whole life.
Yeah.
But no, I was raised being of service. I was raised to have empathy. I was raised to care for others. I've worked with a lot of people that don't. And that's shocking to me. I don't understand that. It's part of the human condition that I don't relate to and I don't like. And it does seem to be rewarded here. You're right.
Well, if you're not grounded, it's such a...
It's also just so boring. Ugh. These people are just so gross. It's like, ew. So tiresome.
Well, it's a very narrow slice of the world, which, of course, we all forget very a narrow. Lot in the bubble.
Right. I don't. That's my thing is, I think, because I grew up as a world traveler, I grew up on the world stage. Yeah. I grew up with the world being my backyard. Mm. I never had a thing where this, I came from Ohio and this was like a huge thing for me. This is a part and always has been, and I've always known it was part of my journey. I wish it wasn't. I wish the last 7 years weren't as messed up as they were. But, you know, shit happens. Why not me? Why not to me? Why, you know, my father said that when he was dying. He said, you know, I did ask him. I said, do you ever feel like, why you? And he said, no, I asked, why not me? Why should I be exempt? Why should it be somebody else and not me?
So is this the second act?
I think
we're
so.
We're at the beginning of the second act?
I think so, for sure. Should we wait till the plane clears?
You never know what the sound's going to be like when the plane clears or doesn't.
Sometimes I'm programmed, I'm programmed. Fantastic. I'm programmed to, like, pause.
Oh, you should see when we have DPs and the light shifts. They're all like, you need to move the light. You need to move the lights, don't you? I'm like, no.
You're just like, keep it's talking. Okay. It's okay. Which DPs have you talked to?
A bunch of them over the years. But Ellen Curtis was. I sat at the table over here, and the light. We did not have the lighting was not as good back then, and she noticed the light shift from the window.
She's great.
She was like, we have to.
And you're like, stand down. Yeah. No, it's. I'll be somewhere at a restaurant, and if I hear heavy, I'll just.
Just stop.
Wait. Reset.
The funniest one was shooting Deacons, who my DP at the time, who was not this gentleman behind me, but somebody else, completely freaked out, like complete meltdown, because they were so scared of lighting Deacons. It was like he was a god on earth.
Well, I totally can understand that.
Yeah.
That would give me pause, too.
But a very easygoing guy. That's the thing. He's like the sweetest guy in the world. So.
Well, that's always kind of how it is. And it is funny when you meet people that try to go...
What is that, isn't it? I mean, there's that sense of people being important.
See, I get awed by those people. It's not important. I think there is that with some people, but I think for me, like when I met Dante Ferretti, I almost passed out. An amazing production designer. Oh my God. You know, when I met Vilmos Zsigmond, I almost passed out. These are the people that I respond to. Hmm. Those are the people that I geek out over.
And they're nice people, generally.
They're artists.
Yeah.
And I think that's what I like.
I think people forget it's work. And, you know, even for people who are masterful, that in the end they're doing something they love, which is great, but they're also...
Doing their job.
Working their asses off.
They're working their asses off.
Beautiful.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, that's what we're all here for, ultimately, is to try to, hopefully...
Yeah.
To not... I don't mean the world.
And certainly not in Hollywood. But...
Right. Well, that's what gets really, really hard when you're doing stuff and you don't feel like it's artful.
Yeah.
You know? And you have a more artistic sensibility, it's difficult.
Well, it's interesting to watch people turn that corner, because there are people who, you know, it can be so overwhelming, and as you know, obviously, from the experience, but it's so overwhelming to people, and then when they get to a certain age, a certain moment, something happens, and they're like, oh my, I really actually want more than I'm getting, even though I seem to have everything in the world that people ask for, it's really not enough.
Well, that's also part of it. Like, what kept me in it for so long, or kept me in a box, was what is wrong with you, don't complain, like, not that I would, but, you know, helicopter.
It's coming for you, apparently. They're looking for you.
They are.
We had an airplane crash into a building here.
What?
We had an airplane crash into a building two blocks away once. That was great.
Oh, I remember that. Yeah. My friend lives two blocks down on the street.
I was on an IM with a publicist who then said, "Are you alive?" her next IM, when there were IMs.
That's pretty intense.
From AOL, because it was like literally she saw the thing on the TV that a plane crashed in my neighborhood. Anyway.
Well, I'm glad it
didn't
hurt. Didn't.
I am too.
I'm glad you're here.
I'm feeling good about it.
I'm feeling good about you. I'm feeling good about you not being dead too.
But the trap of being in the box.
The trap of being in a box. The whole thing of, you know, this don't complain, or don't complain to yourself. Really, it wasn't like that. I was ever vocal. I would never do that. I would feel way too embarrassed to ever do that. Because I have self-awareness, I think, of what is kind of important and what's not. So when I start thinking of all the people in this town or all the people in the world that are constantly just saying they would trade places with you in a heartbeat, or just want to be you, I should say, or want what you have, right? Or what you're perceived to have. Then you're like, don't complain. This is so many. That was one of my things when the power went out. It was like, this is so many people's dreams. And then my answer was like, yeah, but it's not mine. And that's okay.
Yeah.
It's okay to have more of a dream, too.
Which pisses people off, too. If you say you actually don't want something anymore that you have access to, people assume you're crazy, I think. Or that you've done something wrong, or that there's some other alternative.
I have punched nobody out on an elevator, nor dragged them by their hair.
So this, the event...
I have hurt nobody.
The event downtown, with your movie basically qualifying for Oscar for a week at this theater, I'm guessing that you went there, you made arrangements to get your movie, and then we're like, well, if I'm here, let's do something more
interesting. That's exactly it. Well, I want to do something more interesting. I don't want it just to focus, you know, on me, or Dawn, I should say. And so, yeah, it's hard to find DCPs of what's available, right? So that's hard in the first place, finding older films. At first, I was going to do just all classics, and then it was just impossible to find those DCPs to run. So, and they're like, well, we can do it on a Blu-ray. And I'm like, yeah. At a big, beautiful screen, I was like, no, I'm going to find something. So, but it was actually good. It honed it in. It honed it more that of what I thought, you know, I've seen Tonight at Premieres, Dawn premieres with Thelma and Louise afterwards, and I've seen Thelma and Louise 7 times in the theater. I saw that when I was really young. And it was funny now with RSA, that linking together.
Yeah.
Richard Kelly's introing it, because I was speaking to him recently, and he almost teared up, and he had such great passion for Thelma and Louise that... he's introing it, and I love Rich Kelly. He's great. Then we have Carrie. Then we have Silence of the Lambs and Rosemary's Baby, 16 Candles, because I know, whatever. And then ending it with The Parent Trap.
Was it the New York LA Times that slapped that, like, as the one choice that wasn't really a great choice?
Yeah.
Or some piece, and I was like, why would you slap 16 Candles? It's a great movie.
It's a great movie. It's a teenage film. Yeah. This is a teenage film.
Yeah, it was a weird...
Well, it does stand out as a slightly odd choice, but it was also, you have to understand what's available, which is not much. And two, I love that movie, and I would like to see it. And if I am paying for things to be on a screen, because I had I had a small fund set aside
for
this
stuff.
That's
the way it is these days, yeah.
Just do it yourself, you know? I sold a ring to finance Dawn. And it was an engagement ring, didn't need it anyway.
Letting it go. Letting it all
Bye.
Go.
I was happy about that. I was like, oh, good. Something worthwhile is coming of this.
Yeah, I love 16 Candles as a choice.
I love that movie.
People, Breakfast Club would be the alternate choice that people would go, oh, that's the choice. But it's kind of like, people getting off of other Hitchcock movies to be all Vertigo.
Yeah.
Like, Vertigo has now become the one thing you can like in Hitchcock without being, you know, it's embarrassing to like anything else as much. And that's
Why?
The only movie. Because, you know, it's the hipster thing. It's,
I don't
you know,
care
sight
about
and sound
that.
Poles and all that kind of stuff.
I mean, I love his experiment with rope. Farley Granger, I want to slap in the movie because he's histrionic. I would have toned his thing way down. But I love and admire somebody who tried to do something with only one cut in it. I mean, there's so many.
Yeah.
Hitchcock. I mean, he was a master. Why would it's only hip to like one thing? Well, piss off.
I think the first Hitchcock I saw was actually in a theater, or probably at all, at that age, was Family Plot when it came out in a theater. And it gave me a jaundiced view of Hitchcock at that age. And then I went back and I figured
And you went
out.
Back. I'm such a nerd. I do want to go on the Vertigo tour in San Francisco. You can go to all the places, the spot where, you know, she jumped into the water and like all that kind of totally nerd. But I'm not just doing that. It's because it's the only Hitchcock tour that I've found that's available.
Yeah.
But that's my plan. I'm doing that in a couple of weeks.
So are you looking forward at this point, or are you
completely
just moving forward? Are you thinking 2 years out and 3 years out, or are you?
Kind of, yeah, and I never could do that before. I never could look forward, because you don't know what's coming as an actor. You have no idea. People say, what are your plans? I'm like, I don't know. Like, couldn't tell you. I could not be here for 5 months in 2 days. I have no clue. Mm-hmm. I grew up like an itinerant gypsy. I went to 10 different schools in 11 years in between being homeschooled. When the cops would get called, there's a bunch of rowdy kids in a house. What are they doing? Because it's not like my parents did it with an accredited way to do it. Mm-hmm. So I went to all these different schools, like lived all over the place, movies. I mean, it is very weird, the commonality with so many actors that I have that had really itinerant lives. And directors and everybody, like we're this funny band of weirdos, and I like that. You know, that's a cool thing to be a part of.
Being driven enough to actually do things is a challenge.
Being driven enough to do things is great.
But I think that it almost requires a questionable upbringing in certain ways, something that gets that engine stoked to the point where you actually finish. You know, because everybody talks about doing this and everybody talks about doing that, but then there are people who actually go out and do it.
Yeah, I'm a doer. And now that I can do my own stuff, it's really even more. So I have 3 docuseries that I created that I just partnered with Relativity on to go out and sell. So I'm really excited about that.
Which you will direct episodes of, or exec mm-hmm. produce? Or
yeah, both, probably, yeah. Mm-hmm. I'll set the look, for sure. Mm-hmm. Very controlling with that. Yeah. I don't want anything, I no longer want anything associated with my name to not be representative of kind of me, in a way.
And
I have two films lined up to do as an actor too.
And documentary is a format that you love, or that you're interested in, or that
docuseries.
So what does that mean exactly?
It means one of them is an adventure show, but like in war zones, things like that. Although Syria is a bit tricky. One is about the American experience, and I want to take like groups of like, say, if you're in a little town and this is an area that doesn't like, say, immigrants, like introducing a whole bunch to you. And then the next is going to be introducing part of the gay community to this community, like basically taking people that believe they hate each other and finding the commonalities. That's one of my goals. That's one of the things I'm working on. Another one, there's a very well-known drug that's been around for a long time, and I'm developing a series based on that, the origin story of that. I'm doing the origin story of the cult I grew up in. So yeah, some stuff.
So you're taking things that have a certain kind of, you have to take a certain kind of action to make the whatever's going to happen in front of the camera happen, and then you just film it from there?
It's but in an intelligent and thoughtful way. You know, no, I mean, and I...
Well, it's not utopia, I'm sure.
No.
They're getting the hell kicked out of them this week.
No. So watch them get their asses kicked in this week. No, I have a friend who's Jewish and gay. He's never been outside of LA or New York. He's terrified that he's going to get killed and the rest of this. So I'm making him go to places too. Be like, bye, have fun.
Make him into a star.
No, I'm going to make him into a man. I'm going to make him into a person of the world.
So you get to indulge all of your favorite things, which are
exactly
influencing your friends and making films and saying something.
Yes. Yeah. Why not? How fun.
You must
fun.
Be about as excited as you've been.
Ever.
This is it.
This is it. I finally, like, I'm like, oh, it's all kind of like coalesced, and to be able to realize that, again, for me, it was always feeling like, as an actor, like, I know what I'm capable of doing, and I know what I have done, but let's say it's in a genre movie, so it doesn't get recognized, mm-hmm. or whatever it is, I didn't fall into a career of, like, I don't know that I would have ever been an America's Sweetheart. I don't know what that is exactly, but there's nothing wrong with that. I fell into some weird pocket that I couldn't really get out of.
You never had your David Russell or your...
I never had a champion.
Marty Scorsese or whoever.
I never had a champion.
Yeah.
That's okay. They might still be there. And you know what? I'm my own champion, and that's cool. And I'm going to champion a lot of other people too, because there's a lot of worthy people out there. That I think other people in the world would like to know as well. Yeah.
Excellent.